Thank you for coming to our last of our summer club programs, which have been just marvelous, I think. I want to thank all of you who helped in any way make these programs work. We appreciate all that you've done. It's been a lot of fun. And don't forget the Monday, August the 7th, for the picnic, when we will continue our stories again. And today, we're very fortunate to have Andy Andrews and his entourage, who have been to Normandy and who have been on the track of Andy's unit from World War II. We're very glad to have with us Maury Hurt, who is a member of our community, a longtime Montreater, also a local architect, and the son of a former president of Montreat College, Bill Hurt. And Bill McCaskill, a longtime Montreater, who's lived full-time in Montreat for 21 years, and who loves everything that Bill Fortune on the other end has been teaching us, and of course has enjoyed everything with Andy Andrews this year. And then skipping over Andy for a moment to Dr. Bill Fortune on the end, and I'm one of many in the community who will take anything that Bill Fortune teaches when McCall offers it, and there are many in this audience who agree with that completely. We're very fortunate to have Bill here at Montreat College. And then we come to our local hero, Andy Andrews. He's a little uncomfortable with that, but and he has been accused of having some ownership of the Black Mountain paper because he's shown, his picture's shown so many times here. Downstairs, we will have, this was the boy's life several years ago. You didn't know I had that. Had him featured on the front of that with this entire article that had to do with a trip to Normandy when the Eagle Scouts went, and I think you will really enjoy that. And then I also brought, again, I've showed you this before, but when Andy told me that on VE Day, when we were all talking about where various people were, like Horace on VE Day, and he said, well, I was still fighting the war on VE Day in Czechoslovakia, because they didn't know the war was over. And this is the paper I was referring to that has on the front page how the Nazis were still fighting in Czechoslovakia. So we'll discuss that later. But Andy is a treasure here. He is our hero. We appreciate so much your taking your time to come here. And we know that your willingness to share your stories from World War II have a lot to do with honoring the people that did not come back or did not come back home. And we appreciate you being here.
This really isn't my tour, it's Maury Hurt's tour. He was the organizer about over almost 2 years ago. He and six other young men like Maury took me to the D-Day Museum in New Orleans. And we were there when the gates opened at 8:30 or 9, and we stayed until they chased us out at 5 o'clock. We took in the entire museum, and it was fascinating. Not long ago, Maury told me, at that experience, he decided to try to get a group to go back to the Normandy Beach area because he had been fascinated with that since he was a high schooler. And sure enough, he started talking about it, and some of us started listening, and I was fascinated with the prospect. And let me just digress a moment to say it is true that a lady called me and asked me if I owned the Black Mountain. I said, no ma'am, I don't, but I own the newspaper that prints it. So. This was a fascinating experience, an enjoyable experience, but one that tore at our hearts. And many times during this trip, our hearts were in our throats, and we couldn't talk. We just stood and drank it all in. So I would like to start with one of the major comments that I want to make today, and that is the enormous, the massive buildup for the invasion in England. I don't know why England didn't sink down into the ocean. There was so much material. I can recall looking down England's country roads for miles and see nothing but tanks lined up right next to, close to each other. And then jeeps.
Did you bring the jeep?
Like the one parked right out here.
It's quite late, I couldn't get started.
But he's got a real World War II jeep out there if you want to look at it after the program. And ambulances, as far as you could see. Half tracks, cannons, big guns, stacks of ammunition. Just really Quonset huts as far as you could see down these little English roads on both sides of the road. And under each hut, 36 tons of artillery shells. You could see stacks of food, stacks of medical equipment, all kinds of equipment that is required for an invasion. And just think, all of that stuff had to be brought over to England from the United States. Millions of tons of shipping were sunk by the Nazi U-boats. Never got to their destination. And give this a thought too. All of that material had to be loaded again on trucks, taken to the loading docks in England, and loaded on ships and boats of every description, and taken across nearly 100 miles of ocean to the landing areas on Normandy Beach. An amazing feat, an amazing collection of manpower and material. And the thing that boggles my mind every time I think of it is the responsibility that each person had to get that material where it is and onto the ships and onto the beach area. It was said, and it is true, that for every single soldier on the front line, there are at least 12 in the rear echelon doing all of the work that I've tried to describe. And that's a tremendous accomplishment. Now, along with this kind of description is the, I'll try to describe the beach area. General Rommel himself called it the Devil's Garden. The Germans put 1,200,000 tons of steel into obstacles on that beach area. 17 million cubic yards of concrete. 400,000 anti-tank mines and personnel mines hidden in the sand, also on top of the steel bars in the ground in the sand. 500,000 other obstacles of all kinds. Miles and miles and miles of barbed wire, every foot of which had steel shards sharp as a razor. These are some of the obstacles that the Allies were facing. And when you think of the fact that there were 80,000 German soldiers in the area of Normandy Beach, that's a tremendous force. But the overwhelming force that the Allies had, the United States, Canada, and England, were 150,000 men, 30,000 vehicles of all kinds that I've said something about, 6,000 ships and boats, and 7,000 aircraft. When you consider that overwhelming force striking the beach, you get a picture mentally of the anguish, the suffering, the devastation, and the death. In Omaha Beach alone, 2,400 men died, and about 9,000 were wounded in the first few hours. The landings continued for about 3 days. In my case, I actually did not get on the ground of the beach on Normandy on June the 6th. I am given credit, and I got 5 points for being in the Normandy Division because I was 11 miles out on a troop carrier waiting to come in. The troop carrier carried 5,000 fully armed fighting men. And that troop carrier left Portsmouth at midnight, as most of the others did, and came to the stopping point 11 miles from the beach. And when we got out on the deck, ready to go down the rope ladders, we heard the announcer, or rather the megaphone from the beach to the officer on deck saying, "Don't send the guys now. There are too many dead men on the beach. There's no place to land." So we had to wait until 4:30 the next morning for our trip down the rope ladders into the Higgins boats. One of the most fascinating things that I remember in the entire war was being on the deck of that troop ship within 50 yards of the SS Texas battleship, firing those big turrets, those three big turrets, three decks of them, into the beach and into the area right behind the beach. Every time they fired, the sky filled with fire and smoke, and I remember saying to myself, "What a show. I wouldn't miss this for anything in the world." I actually said that to myself. 2 hours later, I sure changed my mind. I didn't want to be there. Neither did anybody else. But we were there. And this was the fact. Down the rope ladders into the Higgins boats. You can imagine our excitement when we discovered the Higgins boats were made out of plywood. The only piece of iron on it, there were two pieces, one holding the engine, the motor, and the ramp that went down like this and across which we went into the water. The Higgins boats hold 36 soldiers, 35, fully armed. When we got down the rope ladder into the Higgins boats, it was floating in 4 and 5 foot waves and bouncing like this. And when it came up against the side of the ship, we would drop from the rope ladder into the Higgins boat. And then it would go out and wait again. Some of the guys dropped between the boat and the Higgins boat and were never seen again, mostly because we had 80 pounds of in our pack. All kinds of ammunition, hospital stores, everything you can think of in the assault waves packed so that we could get this equipment on the beach somewhere or other. And one of the best ways with all these guys walking or swimming or trying to wade through the water to get to the beach. So this was our experience. Most of the guys in the Higgins boats were vomiting, throwing up. One guy threw up right in the back of my shirt and went all down through my uniform. That's not very pleasant to talk about. It was not very pleasant to be there. But everybody was throwing up, and the facts are, you wondered, how can we fight if we're sick? But when we got to the beach area and heard the bullets hitting the ramp, you got over being seasick real fast. And I was glad to be dumped out in almost chest deep of water to wash the puke off of me so I could get on into the beach area. This again is not very pleasant, but that's war, and that's the way things were. I do want to share with you something that I've thought about many, many times, and that is, what did the enemy think when they saw this armada coming? I'm going to read to you a German major's comment. "We watched absolutely petrified as the armada steadily and relentlessly approached. To my horror and amazement, I could clearly see the guns of the fleet being elevated as they swung slowly around to point in our direction. A lilac-colored flare was sent up. The shells screamed like 1,000 express trains, and all seemed to be converging on our positions. One shell hit the base of our bunker, and a bunker is 13 feet thick with concrete. One shell hit the base of our bunker and shook the entire structure. I was thrown to the ground and my binoculars were crushed. There was dust, powder, dirt, splinters of concrete going through the building like a grenade, all over the place. Men were screaming and yelling, but no one seemed to be really hurt. The whole thing was unbelievable to me. I was dazed and unable to speak. That's just one man's view. Later, a German general on the beach outside of the bunker was heard to say, "The Americans just kept coming." And that was the whole idea of getting onto the beach, not only onto the beach, but inland, so that all of this equipment could be brought inland. And the British had these artificial piers that they floated over behind the assault craft and the assault troops, and built piers on which were unloaded tanks and weaponry, guns, big guns, jeeps, ambulances, mile after mile of them coming across these artificial piers, going up the beach and getting inland. I wanted to say that one of the most amazing things to me of this trip was remembering the terrible waste of war. On the little trip that we took, 85,150 men were killed in action. 150,300 were wounded. In the whole European campaign, 183,352 were killed in action, 478,819 wounded. All, you wonder, we won the war by God's grace. We won the war. And we were faced with every soldier, every German soldier, with this belt buckle in God, well, God with us. That's what this buckle says, God with us. Every soldier that I ever saw, dead or alive, had that buckle. The propaganda machine convinced all the Germans they were fighting and this was God's will. We had the same purpose. We had a freedom purpose. And we felt it was God's will. And we fought people, and let me tell you, we fought people that fought under this banner, that were sworn to allegiance under this banner for years in their training. And they felt they were doing the right thing. We, of course, by God's grace, changed their mind. And we freed millions of people and lots and lots and lots of millions of refugees. That's the sad part of war. This is the first part of my talk. Now, who wants to be saved? You're closest.
I guess I'm elected. Very briefly, I want to speak about the wonderful guide that we had to take us on this journey that we went on. He was a retired Army colonel in the British Army. But not only that, with the wealth of knowledge that he had had, a career Army officer, he was also a historian. And the combination of the historian and his military training, he was able to give us insights into so many different things that you would not find on the ordinary tools. I have a booklet that he prepared for all of us. And this will be on display downstairs when when this program is over. But we had this booklet which took a lot of pre-planning for this guy, Andrew Duff, to put together. And it chronicled our trip and where we were going. It has maps, letters, pictures, all sorts of things that added to our knowledge of where we were going. But Andrew did a wonderful job. He was an excellent tour guide. Every day we started with a little briefing. Sometimes they turned into be right long briefings about the situation as it was on that particular day back around the invasion. And he talked about the organization of the United States Army, the British, the Canadian, and the German. And we had got an insight into the order of battle of the different units with each of the armies and how they played out. Then we talked a little bit about the tactics of what happened back then during those particular battles. And then we went to see the ground and see the various places where these things took place. And it meant so much to see these things, and so many of them were things that I had remembered in reading about it in years since the war, and going to various classes and listening to things that happened, but this just brought it closer to home. And we discussed it, and we talked about it, and the positives and negatives of it. But overall, everything was a sense of awe. A sense of awe that we were in, wherever we were, it was a sense of hallowed ground because of the tremendous amount of carnage and death and everything that took place everywhere we went. And it was a very humbling experience, but it's one that I'll never forget.
I don't know how much I can add to that. I don't consider myself an important part of the story. I did sort of conceive it and help me set it up, but the two most valuable players certainly were Andy Andrews and Andrew Duff, our guy. And I'll say I've got, I also put downstairs about 25 or 30 just one sheet information sheets about Andrew. And if any of you ever plan to do a military tour in Europe, whether it's World War I or World War II or even a war that happened in the previous century, this is your man. I hope you will take one of these if that's something that you plan to do someday. It was truly an honor to be part of this tour. I've studied World War II since I was about 8 years old, and this is the first time I've ever really gotten to walk in the footsteps of men like Andy and the other thousands and thousands of soldiers that fought that war for us, and it was truly an honor.
Well, sure, that's not all you're going to say.
Well, I disagree with Maury on one point. Never would have happened if you hadn't put it together. And Maury displayed remarkable logistical skills and organized the entire thing. It would not have happened if you hadn't done all the work that you did, way above and beyond Call of Duty. And I still owe you some money. Let me just share a couple of vignettes of just the moments that stick out. We boarded the ferry to cross the channel in the evening. And just at dusk, the ferry left. Big boat. We're motoring out, smell of diesel. Portsmouth Harbor is getting dark. We're passing some warships. And it was so powerfully evocative. As we remember, we stood on the fantail, and at one point we even prayed. It was. I remember my friend General Bennett. How many of you ever had the pleasure of meeting my friend General Bennett? I helped him write his autobiography some years ago. And he described standing on the deck of his ship, and he said, the ocean was paved with steel, as far as you could see. And he said he remembered leaving England behind and thinking, if I die, this is worth dying for. To save England, to save America, to kill fascism. And I couldn't help but to connect to that. As we were heading out, I kept thinking, what that must have looked like that night. Next day, we were standing on the beach, and again, it was something related to my friend General Bennett, who recently passed. General Bennett received a DFC for securing the left flank. He got mixed in with a unit that was not even his. Of the 22 landing craft that went into his sector, Fox Green, 21 were destroyed. He suddenly finds himself taking over an infantry company. I didn't find out until he was dead, and in fact put a revolver to the head of the captain of that company, who panicked, and told him to get up and start moving, and the captain couldn't, so Don said I had to do it. I asked Don, how did you do it? And he said, well, I realized, Bill, somebody had to stand up and go forward. So I put my faith in God and I stood up. Well, I stood at the spot where he stood up. The bunker, the signs of where you were sitting. The walls on the bunker were as thick as this table. And Don had described that a 5-inch artillery shell could be pumped in from a destroyer only 300 or 400 yards away. It would just bounce off like BBs off a piece of steel. And these shells were going over his head as he and his comrades crawled forward. Finally took, remember that bunker? Just how incredible it was. And stand there and put my hand on that. And then I'm looking at where he had landed. And it's as far away from that bunker as the back row to us. That's how close he was to this monstrous bunker that had to be taken if we were going to go forward. The toughest one for me, and you guys know I can get emotional on some of this stuff. We visited any number of cemeteries, and I'll tell you, by the end of the trip, I was really dealing with a lot of depression. There was just one too many cemeteries. And it's interesting how the cemeteries are reflections of national character. The German cemeteries are very somber places. The headstones are laid into the ground, and they'll simply read 5 unknown soldiers, 12 unknown soldiers, 2 unknown soldiers, and then maybe one with a name. The American cemeteries you are familiar with, of course, from St. Louis Private Ryan or having visited them. They're places of honor. Something that touched me at the cemetery in Luxembourg, where General Patton is buried, as we got there just about as it was closing, there was gunfire recorded and then taps. We all came to attention, and then they played 2 songs. But they were not what you would think they would play. Patriotic songs, God Bless America, something like that. The songs were Blue Skies and White Cliffs of Dover. The popular songs that these 19-year-old guys would have listened to. What caught me in standing in the cemeteries was we tend to focus on who was buried. I found myself very haunted by looking at the graves and thinking, who are the parents that would have been standing next to them? The girlfriend, the wife, the brothers, the sisters, whose life had been taken away from them. And yes, even all the children that were there. That should have been. The one I have to take a deep breath on is the British cemetery. Andrew took us to this British cemetery near the beachhead. And Andrew was very, and this is our guy, was very, very touched by the fact that we became so emotionally involved in it. In fact, he was very, he said, he was thanking us. He says, you know, usually Americans don't know me. They want to go to the one that's in the movie, but then they want to drive on. He said, but I want you to come to this cemetery. Well, what's our thing to the Brits? Stiff up a little. Yes, lads, let's go forward. Hip, hip, hurrah. Et cetera, et cetera. Andy's son and I actually had to hang on to each other as we left that cemetery. We were crying so hard. Because there are the headstones, and the Brits being very Brit, they'd have the military crest of the regiment and the name of the regiment. You know, the 2nd Guards or the 3rd Shropshire Rifles. You know, all these really cool names the Brits had. And then there would be the name of the soldier, his age, date of death. And then the families were allowed to make a little statement that would be put at the bottom of the stone. And many of the stones had the quote from the famous poem by Rupert Brooke, a corner of a foreign field that is forever England. But 2 that will haunt me forever. One was, on the day you died for England, we lost our entire world. And And then one, Andrew's son and I just totally lost it. Three words. Our darling baby.
Let me add one more that I saw that was written on the bottom of the stone. It says, "You will always be our dad."
One of the, the most haunting place that we visited on the tour, I think we would all agree, was the Hurricane Forest. Those of you that don't know the history of that battle, it occurred in late 1944, and it's one of those battles that in hindsight, a lot of strategists would agree that it probably didn't really need to be fought. It was one of the bloodiest, most brutal battles that the Americans were involved in during the entire European theater part of the war. It is a pine forest. The pines are planted probably on average about 4 to 6 feet apart. So it's very, very dense. The canopy of the evergreen needles makes it almost dark on the forest floor. When you walk across through the Hurricane Forest, the ground is completely hard to describe, but the texture of the ground is like it's been shelled so much. There's so many foxholes dug that you have to watch your step very carefully not to fall into one of them. It's like the surface of a golf ball, but the holes are 4 to 8 feet around. Anyway, there's pieces still of the battle strewn all over this forest. Pieces of aluminum from aircraft that were shot down, pieces of shells that exploded. And most of all, there are still a lot of soldiers left on that battlefield. One of the things that we were privileged to see was one that was discovered just a few years ago. And the family had memorialized him and basically built a grave for him right there in the middle of the forest. It is terrifying because you could be walking and then 20 or 30 feet ahead of you realize that what you thought was just a clump of trees is actually a bunker that would have held in 1944 machine guns, cannon, that would have killed you way before you would have ever even seen it. And that's how a lot of people in the Hurricane died. And I wonder if Andy was in that battle and fought it, could you tell us what it was like 62 years ago?
The Hurricane Forest battle, in that battle, the Americans lost 29,000 men killed. And Hurricane Forest covers a lot of territory, a lot of miles, maybe 20 miles, but the main battle was in the area where we were. And if you saw the movie Band of Brothers, that was very much like our outfit. As a matter of fact, I think Maury and some guys took me to see that movie. And when the soldiers in the movie built a fire in the forest and it created smoke, I yelled, incoming artillery, put the fire out. And about that time, incoming artillery did come in and killed a bunch of those guys. My story is that our outfit was in the forest, and we were under a barrage of artillery, German artillery. And when it comes into tall trees like that, they hit the tops of the trees and create tree bursts in which the artillery explodes and everything comes down, just showers whatever's on the ground. We were trying to dig a foxhole, but the water was so wet that the water came into the hole as we dug it. And one particular shell hit one of my buddies, Tom Simon, right in the shoulder. And I looked over and I saw Tom, and his face was in the pine needles and the leaves and the sticks. And he yelled the saddest thing I heard in my whole war experience. Mother! Mother! Mom! And then he passed into eternity.
All right, Andy's going to tell him this.
Kirk and Forrest was like a time machine. We were walking through it as Maury rightly described it. It was like the surface of golf balls. I saw a lot of symbolism in this because, I mean, there were the trenches, there were the foxholes, there were the bunkers, covered with pine needles, maybe eroded slightly, but it was almost as if it was just yesterday. In fact, how many of you did see Band of Brothers with the... Later we actually had Gaston. A couple of us went out to Foy and found where Easy Company was.
Could you speak more into
the Bible? We actually went out to where Easy Company was. But the time machine for me was, here are all this wreckage and the foxholes, but yes, age has eroded them in slightly. And the forest has grown back to cover the wounds. And then I would look over at my buddy here. And what are you, 55, 60? and yeah, I can tell you that I would look at Andy's face, and there were moments that I'd look at him, and maybe you guys would agree. I wasn't looking at an 82-year-old man. I was looking at a very hard 20-year-old. Who had a bit of the thousand-yard stare. I don't even want to talk about what we saw at Hill 232, which I think is about the worst night of your life. A very surreal storm came up. I've never been outside my life in a storm. I've been out in deserts and Asia and everything else, where I've seen storms. This thing was beyond belief, wasn't it? I mean, it must have been 800 mile per hour winds. Do I exaggerate?
Hurricane.
Yes, it was like a hurricane. And was coming in, and yet this guy was going up that hill because that was the spot. That was the spot that had been in his life for 60 years. So there was this time machine sense a lot of stepping back, looking, seeing, stepping forward. And so many times I look at Andy, and I'm looking at the face of a 20-year-old. Maybe some instincts don't die. Let me try and put just some light, just a light moment here for a second. We're following the path of Gaston, the campaign from the German side. So I'm sitting up front, and our tour guide was incredible. Said to me, Bill, you're the map man. Now, you would be like the staff officer. I'm Piper, the German commander. And so we're zigzagging these roads from the days of Gaston, where the Germans are trying to get across rivers. And our engineers would blow the bridge. And okay, you got to circle around. And I'm saying to my guy, okay, how much time do we have? You know, what time is it? How far do we go? Where do we go? And we come around the corner and the road, and I look up, and Andy's sitting there. Now, remember, this is a brick car. So he's the driver. Andy and I are snuggled up. And a split second later, Andy's got me, and he's trying to push me out. All right? I think he's going to climb over me. And I look up, and I will not sit. And I made a scatological something comment. Because there's a German King Tiger tank just around the corner with a barrel going straight at us. And I think Andy, the instant you saw that, it's like, I'm getting out of here now. Yeah, this big dumb blue goes out with me, okay. But if not, I'm gonna climb over.
Okay. That thing weighs 68 tons. Since he mentioned Hill 232, I'm gonna tell you the story of it. Hill 232 was really just a hill like this down, maybe a block long, and the Germans were on top. And when I say Germans, I simply mean the enemy. My grandfather was a surgeon in the German army in the First World War. So as far as I know, I was killing family. So I don't talk about the Germans as someone I hate, though General Eisenhower and all the other generals tried to get the soldiers to hate. They said you can kill better when you hate. That's not really true. I killed soldiers from the Normandy Beach to Czechoslovakia, and I dug foxholes all the way. I claim I know more about the soil in Europe than the county agents do. But anyway, on Hill 232, we attacked that hill running with all of our packs, our machine guns on our back, across an open field, and you could hear the rifle shells coming from the hill. But the Germans left that hill, and we got up on it, and were in control as night fell. We knew that the Germans would want that hill because the Germans want high ground. All of us want the high ground. Any troop wants the highest ground it can get for observation purposes. So that night, 12 o'clock came, nothing happened. 12:30, nothing happened. Midnight, I'm talking about dark. Couldn't see your hand in front of your face. 1:30, everything exploded. All of the men, they sounded like 250 men down below the hill coming at us, yelling like Indians, you know, woo, like that, as loud as they could. And we were looking this way, and all the while, a German crack ranger group was sneaking around the side and up behind us, and they killed 18 of our men on two machine guns right above us. And just about the time they started shooting down at us, about as far as from here to where you are, front row, a large artillery shell hit where they were and killed all of them. And it was called in by an American artillery observer. Well, our two machine guns down below were shooting down the hill as these guys came up. And there were so many Americans killed, they were just lying on the sergeants would go up and pull the guys away from their machine guns and just line them up like cordwood. And the sergeant came and said to me, "Andy, I need you on this other machine gun. There are too many enemy over here." So I left and went to this machine gun and started firing. I guess that battle lasted maybe 3 hours, and it began to get light, and the battle began to subside. Just as I saw under my machine gun and scope, I saw a German stand up and throw a grenade, and before he could get down, my bullets were going through his body. And the grenade came right over my head and exploded, hit me in the shoulder, not badly, but it was a wound. And that was the end of that battle, just about. Everything was quiet. Only five Americans were left out of 38. And just then, right in front of my gun, as far as from me, my gun was here, and the little hill was right there. This little flag came up like this on the end of a stick. And I heard the words, "May I surrender? Please, may I surrender?" And I thought it might be a trick, so of course I pulled out. I usually fought with my pistol in one hand anyway. But I had it right on him. I said, "Yes, you may." And this young fellow came up, first of all his face and then his shoulders, and then he curled up, and I reached down and I knew he was wounded badly. And I reached down and pulled him up, and his whole side was just nothing but blood. And he was the guy that threw the grenade at me. And so, arm in arm, we went to the aid station about 150 yards behind us. And on the way, he kept looking over to my side where my pistol was. And he said, "You shoot me?" I said, "No, I'm a Christian." He said, "I'm Christian too. I'm 17 years old. I drafted, just like I was drafted." And he gave to me a little chain with a cross on it. And I still have it, and I tried to find it today, Bill. Bill likes me to bring it all the time. And I missed it today, but he gave that to me. We went to the aid station together, and finally in the same ambulance together, to the same hospital, and as they moved him away and took him to the enemy wing, he looked up and I said, "You're going to be okay." He said, "I okay. I'm alive." So there is another experience in my Christian faith. There's a young man terribly wounded, terribly afraid, who made a decision. His decision was to surrender. And in my Christian life, it's one thing to accept Christ as a Savior, as my Savior. It's quite another to totally surrender. He believed that if he surrendered, he would live. And that's the thing we need to believe as Christians. We surrender to our Lord and we can really live.
Andy, can I ask? We've heard Andy's stories. I'll try to learn. But Andy, for the first time, I heard the story of what took you into youth ministry work while we were there. And you told the story near where it happened. And it was incredible how good can come out of such evil. And I was wondering if you tell the story about the boys and the machine gun.
How's our time? We got time?
Yes. Please speak into the mic, though.
Beg your pardon?
Everybody speak into the mic. Be helpful.
What was that? I agree. I'm a mic man. I tell you, I wasn't thinking it's the only thing to do. I did want to repeat again. When we went up on the L-232, it was raining, pouring rain. Went up a slick road, and it began to hail. Sleet first, and then hail. Big chunks of hail beating down on us, and. The tour guide was with us, and Mark came up with my son, four of us out of the eight, went up on the hill. And it was so blowing, and the tour guide said, hey, let's get over here behind this pile of dirt. And he called it a lee, remember that? Get over here in the lee, and so we can hear you talk. And I was explaining the battle. And one thing that surprised me is that the German nation has decided to do away with the bunkers, to destroy the bunkers that the Germans built, because the neo-Nazi kids, 13, 15 years old, are using them as headquarters for their little groups of Nazis. And so the German government was leveling off Hill 232. A disappointment to me, because I couldn't really explain the battle. But anyway, just before that, there was a machine gun, there was a kind of a low hill that we were coming to, and machine guns, fire was scraping over that hill. And it was coming from one place that we couldn't quite see because it was behind brush. And the captain said, Andrew, go over there and sneak around behind all that stuff, go down in the woods and throw a grenade in that machine gun nest. I said, you mean by myself? I said, by yourself, so you can do it. You've done it before. He's the guy that made me get up and sneak up on a house and kick the door open. He said there was a machine gun nest in the house, and he needed me to go kick the door open and throw a grenade in. Again, I said, you mean by myself? He said, yes. So he got a lot of confidence in me for some reason. I went, I'm going to tell two stories. I went up there and I listened and I heard women talking. I thought, well, I can't throw a grenade in there. But anyway, I did kick the door open, and they were in there making these Nazi flags. They had a table just like this, and red material spread over the top, sewing these little black and white diadems on it. And the one lady could speak English, and she looked up and she said, oh, Americanish. I said, yeah, Americanish. I want that flag. So she said, oh, yeah, it's okay. See, they can understand a 45 pistol looking at it. Most people can. But anyway, that's where I got this flag. And so on this little trip, I went around, I sneaked around, and I got real close to ready to throw my grenade, and I took the grenade, not much bigger than that, a little heavier. I pulled the pin out, and I throw it, use the microphone, and I heard children crying. And I got up a little bit closer and I realized that the sound was coming from this machine gun hole. So I did something a lot of soldiers are afraid to do. I put the pin back in the grenade and stuck it in my belt. That's dangerous because sometimes it doesn't work. But anyway, I got up to the edge of that hole and looked down, and there were three little children. They had a rope going up to the machine gun, which was on a pivot. And their assignment was to keep pulling that rope and shoot machine gun fire over that hill and deter the enemy while the Germans escaped. So I jumped down in the hole, and these little kids were crying, 7 years old. So I says, "Was ist der Name?" That's what's your name, those of you who are German. One was named Henry Heinrich. One was named Heinz, and I've forgotten the other's name. But I had one piece of chewing gum, and I broke it in three pieces and gave each kid a little piece, and they started smiling. Wiped the tears away and took all three of them up in my arm and climbed out of that hole and took them to the burgomaster, the mayor, who knew immediately who they were and took them to their homes. And that's the time I made a decision. I was under the care of Knoxville Presbytery to become a minister. And I made the decision, if Adolf Hitler can do this to seven-year-olds, I can be a youth director.
This tool was set up to go to follow the route that Andy's unit went from the invasion on in through France and Belgium and on into Germany. And while planning for this, Andy was asked, "Did you go here?" And Andy says, "You keep forgetting." He said, "I was a 19-year-old kid. I didn't have any idea where I was." And so the Andrew Duff did the research and found this. And this marked the route that we went. But one thing I wanted to talk just real briefly about is the enormity of Omaha Beach. It's approximately 4 to 5 miles wide. The beach from the water level to the, I guess, to the where the hill kind of rises, maybe 100 feet or something like that, is maybe 300 yards. At each end of the beach were bunkers. German bunkers, that the guns were mounted in these bunkers that were sideways. In other words, the guns were pointed down the beach. And from either end of the beach, those guns could hit anything on the beach because it was just a completely unobstructed view. They played quite a havoc with the when the invasion forces were coming in. They were not easily knocked out from the naval gunfire offshore because the side towards the ocean were, they had 13 or more feet of concrete and then a lot of dirt piled up on them so that they couldn't be knocked out. And so it was after the troops got on the ones that did get on the beach, then they were able to come at and knock out those bunkers. But just standing at one end, and especially at one of the bunkers, and looking down the beach, it was amazing. The distance and how clear you could see, and what a tremendous beach of hell it must have been for the ones that were coming across the beach. But the enormity of everything was just mind-boggling.
Just to give you a visual, if you're at the at the water line on Omaha Beach, and I guess we were there kind of at high tide level. Where the Germans and the guns would have been is something like the roof of Anderson Dorm. Okay, that's how close and how you can imagine, you know, from that vantage point, if you're on a flat beach this close, you're a sitting duck, and you really start to appreciate the courage and the level of sacrifice that was made by our soldiers and the British and Canadian soldiers on those beaches. When you see the terrain, I hope that any of you that are interested have the opportunity to go there and see it for yourself, because it will absolutely knock the breath out of you.
Well, you know, some people say, how'd you have the courage to keep on going? Well, you couldn't go back. There was nobody to take you back. You had to go. There were no boats. The boats were going back to get other guys and bring them. There's no way out. You had to go. And that was one of the exciting things about battle. You had to go forward.
Andy and I actually went to Omaha for the first time in 2003. I was together. When we were working on Assignment for Boys Life magazine. And it's a story worth sharing that on our last morning there, I wanted to get what I would call an experiential moment from the three Eagle Scouts. Not a reenactment or anything, I just want them to experience something and then talk about it, and also the photographer ones. We set the kids up, we didn't tell them what we were going to do. We got to the beach, now this is in July when the water was warmer, and I followed Andy up the slope, and as Maury said, yeah, it's not this, it's this. All right. Got up to the top, photographer down on the beach, and we had told the kids what they were going to do. So at 7 in the morning, they went out into that surf up to their shoulders. And you could hear them going, like, yeah, oh my gosh, this is cool. Now these are three boys. The age, they were 17 and 18 year olds. So they were the age of these guys, right? They were Andy's age. And these were Eagle Scouts, top quality kids, tough physical shape, all of them good sportsmen as well. And then it was like, go. All right. They had to row, wade and swim and get in, go up the shingle, remember, crawl, run, get up to the shingle, the high tide line, and then get to the top. And those three boys got up and they collapsed. And they were shivering, and I could still remember one boy just looked at Andy and he burst into tears. He just sat there and he started crying. And he kept saying, Mr. Andrews, how did you do it? How did you do it? He said, how did you do it? And Andy smiled and said, you'd be amazed what you can do when you're being shot at. the one other impression, yet again, impression to think about. I mean, our tour took us from London. We had an incredible tour of the Blitz in London. Of looking at London, not as, how many of you have been to London? Okay, you know, we go there, we go to the museums, we want to go to the tower, we want to wave at the Queen, but this guy got us to look at London as a battlefield.
Clyde Harris.
Yeah, Clyde. Incredible. I mean, and his knowledge of, you know, this is where the first bomb ever dropped on London during World War I fell and killed a woman in that doorway, right? That was his knowledge. And at places there would be photos of where V2 rockets had hit. And as you know, you go around London, wherever you see a crummy modern building, that was a place that had hit. But what I'm trying to explain here is distance, scale, and time. You talk about history. Okay, guys, today we've done Omaha Beach. Tomorrow we'll talk about the Battle of Bastogne. Then we'll talk about Ramadi. For Andy, I'll never forget Andy, you once saying that as you were going in on the landing career, you kept saying, sweet Jesus, just get me to the beach. Please, dear God, get me to the beach. And then you got to the beach, and it was like, God, please give me the strength to get up that hill. God, please give me the strength to get to that hedgerow. God, give me the strength. I got to go. Okay, give me the strength to get up and get down into that ditch. And then Andy said, I prayed that way, all the way from here to the Rhine. We drove the distance. Remember how long it took? Hour after hour of driving. And I was thinking, my God, Andy walked it. And every day wondering when he got up in the morning. And not just Andy, but the millions of other guys, which, as he pointed out, 178,000 did not come back. That every morning they got up and they said, sweet Jesus, give me the strength to get through today. Some of them didn't come back. I just want to close with my whole thing. Again, it's a story about General Bennett because it sums it up. Don Bennett, I asked him once, what was the most memorable thing of all of his experience of his war in Europe? He described how he came into a village in Holland, and they were the point, and they stopped for a moment. And Recon was racing forward across this flat plain to the next village, a couple of kilometers up the road. He said, we had 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So the guys got out, they light up, they're refilling, they're eating, and suddenly, to make a very long tale short, this Dutch couple comes out of their house leading a family who he said was skeletal and pale white. This Dutch family, with incredible courage, for 4 years had been hiding Jews in the attic. Don wept when he told me that story because he said there was a child about 3-4 years old being held, and she was shaking like a leaf. And she kept looking up, and she was shaking. And Don said he realized at that moment she was terrified because she had never seen the sky. And then he said it was his proudest moment as an American. Because he said, you know what my guys did? These battle-toughened GIs who had seen so much. He said these men started to weep. And then they started reaching into their pockets, and they were pulling out sea rations. They were pulling out candy bars. They were pulling out money. They were pulling out packs of gum. And he said within a couple of minutes in front of this Jewish family, there was a pile of wealth unlike anything they had seen that you and I take for granted today. And yet to them, it's everything. And then the word came, saddle up, get moving. And he said, we loaded up and we drove on. And Don, shortly before he died, said, I've prayed for that child every day since. And I said, you know, Don, she'd be at least 60, 62 years old now. And he said, I never thought about that. And he said, you know what I pray for? That she never remembered it. And she went on to a happy life. And he also said, "This, that's what we were fighting for."
I'm going to sign off by telling you that I don't mind talking about the war. A lot of people say they can't talk about it. Somebody told me here today they can't. And a bunch of people have told me their parents can't talk about it. But I've given 76 talks to little kids in school, fourth grade is the youngest, colleges, universities, civic clubs, and all. And the last time I spoke to fourth graders, they all wrote a letter to me. And the one I enjoyed the most was, Dear Ms. Tranger, thank you for coming to our fourth grade class today. If you had not come, I very probably would have made a F on my history test.
Yeah, her.
I think it'd be nice to leave on a different note. I remember very well Andy giving the impression of the French in Normandy when he went back in 94 at 50th. It made me feel good. You recall that, Andy? How the French appreciated our being there, not the ones in Paris.
Yeah, yeah. Not the one I shot. On the 50th anniversary, our tour of 28 guys went through very small villages. Then what you're talking about, I think. And anyway, we came to every little village had a celebration for us. And the biggest rooms in the villages were usually with the schoolhouse, the schoolroom. And they would have tables like this with tablecloths on it. And the interpreter would tell us they have saved money for 3 months to buy chocolate covered cookies for you guys. And that was just amazing to us. And it was pouring the rain. We went into one of them that was in a courthouse on Sunday morning. And we didn't see anybody in town as we drove through it. We stopped at the courthouse, and our tour guide went in, and he came back in a few minutes crying. He said, the reason you don't see anybody in town is everybody's in the courthouse. There are 3 stories, fellas, 3 flights of steps, and there are people all over both sides of the steps, just enough room to walk through. And they're here for you. And there was a French soldier standing outside of the gate, outside the door, in the pouring down rain with a French flag and an American flag. We stayed in there for an hour and a half talking to these French people. And all these little kids going up the steps, little children, old people on canes and crutches, everybody had an American flag. And when we came out, that man was still standing in the pouring rain. And I walked up to him and saluted. And he saluted back. And that said a lot to me. I don't know if that's the one you wanted to hear, but that's one. You wanted to make a statement?
Yeah, how long were you in England prior to D-Day?
6 months of what they call severe combat training. How to kill somebody at night, how to cut his heart out without even knowing it.
One final thing that I wanted to say was that this tour was made up of 3 different Father Son teams. And Andy and his son, Maury Hurt and his dad, and my son, and it really meant a lot to share some of these experiences with my son. And I'm assuming the same thing was true with Maury and with Andy. But it was a very unique experience, one that I will treasure from now on. And I learned a lot, but it also has made me a lot more humble than I was, because there was such a sacrifice that was made by so many people that we all need to be extra thankful for what all these people did.
Are there any other questions that we might answer before we go downstairs? Shall we retire to the basement?
Close today by singing, if you would stand, God Bless America.